Dozens of hopeful teenagers have to deal with the gut-wrenching pain of rejection at draft time each year. Few will prove the doubters more comprehensively wrong than Paul Couch did during the 1980s and 90s. Welcome, Couchy.
Thanks, Mike.
You should have been a Fitzroy player, shouldn't you?
Well, that we're zoned to Fitzroy, the hand and leg in Warrnambool. And yeah, I should have been there. 83, I played a few practice matches, played well. I think 82, I played another game or two and played very well. But the organisation, there wasn't any. And one bloke said, one recruiter said, well, go and see your mother and father. That was the end of 83. And we'll have a chat about for you to come down. Well, they never turned up.
When you're a teenager and your dream is to play league football and it's suddenly taken away from you, how do you feel?
Well, I wasn't too worried about it, Mike, because I've been used to it all my life. You know, with playing schoolboys, playing under 17, Celtics Cup, you know, I got the best player one game at Mortlake. It never made the first round. And the bloke I played on, he got in and I actually beat him. I just had to concentrate on my farm work, just do that, and hopefully one day somebody might pick me up.
So the Cats come knocking, and you play there. It was a bittersweet relationship at Geelong, wasn't it? I mean, outstanding in terms of your games played, winning the Brownlow medal, 18 finals, 4 grand finals, but no flag.
And it was interesting, in those days, I had no involvement in getting signed up with Geelong. My father had a meeting with Bill McMaster out in the kitchen table, and I was sitting in the lounge and didn't hear a word. Then he said, you've signed with Geelong. I said, well, that's great.
Did Bill walk in with a Gladstone bag full of folding stuff?
Actually, it was no money.
No money?
No money at all.
Couchy, which was the one that got away of the four? There was 89, 92, 94 and 95. Is there one that still burns inside you about that you perhaps should have won?
Yeah, I've got over it a bit, the four grand finals, but 89, we really didn't know what we were doing. When we won the preliminary final, you know, everybody went out and had a few drinks like we did every other week, enjoyed each other's company, and we just went out to play in 89. Probably we were more set in 92. We had a few injuries going into the final. Brunsie had a pretty checkered preparation, and I thought we were ready in 92. So that was probably the one that really got away on us, yeah. 92, 94, we just weren't good enough. And 95, we played probably the best side all year.
Yeah, in Carlton in 95.
Oh, Carlton were unbelievable. Yeah. They were a great side.
Let's just go back to 89. You ended up beaten by 6 points, but I think most of us who saw that game thought that Hawthorn always looked like they had control. Do you agree with that?
Oh, we went the knuckle too early.
Did you?
Yeah, we had, I think Buddha gave about 5 or 6 free kicks away.
Yeah, that's right.
And I said to him in 10 minutes in, I said, look, just calm down, Buddha. You know, we need to concentrate and let's get the ball. Well, his eyes were spinning. He said, he didn't even know what he was. He didn't even know I'd said it. Honestly, he was just completely out of it. And so I thought, oh, geez, we might be in trouble here. But we certainly worked ourselves back into it. And I said to Gazza, I didn't know how many goals Gazza had kicked. I said, because the game was just full on. We just went for it. And that's how you had to play. Again, in finals, you just got to go for it. And if you're the best side in the day, well, you know, good luck and you win it. And I said to Gazza after the game, I'll turn around him, because he had a great final series. Mm-hmm. Sort of turned him and said, Gazza, how many goals did you kick? I thought he kicked one.
One?
Yeah, I thought he kicked one, because you're
8 shy, right? Yeah. You know, the interesting stat about that game was that Hawthorn led by 6 goals at every change. Did you know that?
No, I didn't know that, no.
And yet you pegged it back to 1 goal in the finish. It's regarded as probably the best of the grand finals of the modern era. Difficult to judge that when you're playing it.
It is, yeah. But we had, you know, Hawthorn crying foul about, you know, that we went too hard at him. Mm. You know, Dipper, you know, Gazza cleaned him up. They had 7 or 8 injuries.
Well, but Yates, he went through Dermot.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Well, he probably deserved it. Because he used to get you off the ball a bit, Dermot. He wasn't... he was probably one of the better players I played against.
Tell me about your mindset running out. Did you go out thinking that you guys were going to attack the Hawks?
Physically? Oh, we had to, because we were pretty meek and mild against Essendon in the first qualifying final. We had to be, you know, earn respect. My mindset was, I've just got to go out there and play and do the best I can. Because I'd won the Brownlow on the Monday. Mm-hmm. I trained the Tuesday and I was terrible. I thought, you know, I had to be the best player, which I, you know, Blighty said, you've been the best player for the last 24 or 5 weeks. This week's different. So, and Tuesday night was terrible. I thought, if I go with that mindset of think I've got to be the best, I'm going to play terrible. Mm-hmm. So I switched all the radio, TV off, and just relaxed for the whole week. and do the best I could. The Friday night, I think I had about 2 hours sleep, because you're up and about, yep. You know, you want to do the best you can, and you're...
So you couldn't sleep?
No, I was adrenaline, you know, it was just pure adrenaline, Mike.
You were at the Brownlow, weren't you, that year?
Yeah, no, you know, Buddha was racing ahead, he had 13 votes, and my mate rang me on the Monday or the Sunday night and said, oh, look, you get some votes, you get 22 votes, and... you know, you win the Brownlow, you don't get 3 votes in the last game, and yeah, but that never eventuated.
I'm glad you told us that. So, were you the subject of a plunge that year, betting plunge?
I was sixes into 5-4 that Monday.
Sixes into 5-4?
Yeah, the Mooney Valley races.
That's a plunge, mate. That's a plunge. 12 months before that, in 1988, you spend 4 weeks in the seconds.
That's right, yeah.
How'd that come about? You're 12 months shy of a Brownlow, yeah, and you're playing seconds football.
Well, it's that's an interesting one. John was coaching, John Devine.
Yeah.
And we had a team meeting. You know, what do they call them now, those meetings where you talk about each other and...
What, the leading team
sessions?
Yeah,
well, it wasn't that. John was running the show.
Yeah.
And players were saying, you know, we've got to get rid of him and da-da-da-da-da.
Got to get rid of John.
Yeah, yeah. You know, they were behind his back.
Yeah.
And he's going through each player and asking them what their thoughts were. Then he come to me, and because he was at the top of his voice, he used to get excited. You see him at three-quarter time pointing the finger. He was a bit wound up, and he started pointing the finger at me and said, oh, and you don't think I can coach? He's pointing at me quite aggressively. So my father always said, to be honest, which has probably cost me 4 weeks, he said, look, John, I don't think you're the man for the job.
Really?
And when he's there... He said, Gavin X will sit down, which was behind him. He couldn't see Gavin, but he said, does anybody else think like that? And Gavin X will stood up, and he was the only bloke. And it taught me a life lesson too, that when you're in a team, these blokes are talking about this bloke, and only one bloke backed me up out of the whole lot.
Yep.
So I knew from then, league footy's a pretty lonely world, just
were
be
you
honest.
Dropped? Were you dropped instantly?
Yeah, I got the 4 weeks, yeah. You know, well, probably... In the end, you can't sort of say what you want to say, but I just said it. Because I said to Kenny Gannon, I said, listen, Kenny, might have been a week before or a week after, I said, listen, I'll finish up, Kenny, I've had enough, you know.
At Geelong?
Yeah, I said, we'll finish up. And he said to me, oh, just hang around, things might change. Mm. And that's all he said to me. And I still remember that conversation I had with him.
So did you read that as Ken Gannon saying to you that there was going to be a change of coach?
Yeah.
Yeah,
there was, definitely. I think it was already in the... mix of all the throw things, but I just had to speak my mind. You know, everybody else was going on about it, but you know, and so I just said it.
So in comes Malcolm Jack Blight, 1989. You play grand final the first year. You play 3 grand finals in 6 seasons.
Yeah. And played in preliminary finals. But the first thing he changed, Michael, was the first training session we had at Eastern Beach, and the bloke who was getting a good run by John turned up late.
Who was the bloke?
Oh, Bruce Lindner.
Bruce Lindner, yeah.
Yeah, he just got back from San Fran.
The president?
Yeah, president, yeah. He turned up late. And so he had to get out in front of everybody and explain why he was late. So then I knew we had a chance here.
Because he was a favoured son, Bruce Lindner, wasn't he?
Oh, he was a beauty. They were telling me how good he was.
Yeah,
Bruce, when he was going bad, Bruce, he used to wear different coloured socks under John so he'd get noticed. He goes, Bruce, he must be playing, Paulie. He's got the socks on. And that's true.
Well, you played grand finals in 92 and 94 and missed the finals in 93. What happened?
Well, after 92, Malcolm sort of changed towards us a bit. He sort of... he didn't like any of us, basically. He's seen all our weaknesses and not our strengths. So he probably had, you know... You could say he had the shits with us, I suppose you could say. And well, it was because we'd lost 2 grand finals and he probably blamed himself, but he probably blamed us a lot more. So he played us in different spots and we had 5 weeks to go. And, you know, you could see that it was getting to Blighty, it was getting to the players. And it looked like he had a bit of a breakdown. Or well, I don't know whether he had a breakdown, but he looked in a bit of distress. And he said, I've cost you the year, he said.
You still have what?
Cost you the year.
Cost you the year.
Yeah, wow. He was very apologetic for the year.
Yeah.
This is 5 weeks before. I've done all the wrong things, basically. And Tim Darcy piped up and said, yeah, you've cost us a year. You've cost us. And he said, well, what are we going to do about it? He said, I apologise for it, which is pretty manly thing to do. Most coaches wouldn't do that. They'd be saying they're right all the time. That was a great thing about Blighty. If he did something wrong, he apologised for it. And you got a great respect out of that, and I respect him highly, and I always have. And he said, well, we've just got to go out there, be enthusiastic. We had to play 5 out of the top 6 sides to get into the finals in 93. So we come out, we're enthusiastic, we train hard. He put us back in our spots, and we won 5 out of the top 6, and we miss out by
percentage. Yeah. The off-season of 1996-97, Adelaide appoints Malcolm Blight coach. You say they will win a premiership.
Yeah, I actually rang Mark Best up and said, they'll win it, these blokes. They've got the side for it. All they need is one bloke to go and do it, and that's Blighty.
So the coach can make that much difference, can
he? Oh, yeah, he can make a lot of difference. If I got anything out of footy is that the coach reflects the players. It was interesting, when Blighty, when he came with his Monday speech on a Monday morning, said, oh, I think we can win. We'd get beat. If he came in and said, we're going to win this week, we'd win.
Okay.
And it's as simple as that. If I only took anything away from footy, is that the coach reflects the players.
So to get into your head, to convince you...
Yeah, convince you. Kenny Hinkley does it at, oh, we're the fastest side in the competition.
Yeah.
So they start believing it, the players, whether it's true or not. You know, it's just that positive reinforcement, we're the fastest. And he says it all the time, and I just giggle to myself, because it's a Malcolm Blight throwaway line.
Of all the unusual things that Malcolm did... Catch, is there one that lives on in your mind as the most bizarre of his...
The towels at the MCG. We had to bring a towel and we had to put it on our heads, like we were in a teepee, and little Indians, and we had a Malcolm, Big Chief Malcolm, with a peace pipe, you know, saying, me, Big Chief Malcolm, think should Billy Brownless play centre half back. What do you think, little Indians? Yes, Big Chief Malcolm, you know, Billy.
That's exactly how it happened.
Yeah, and we'd go around and he'd go around each player, you know.
It's just before a game.
Before a game.
Yeah,
we got beat. But I don't really bag him for that, because, well, he was trying something different and trying a different mindset and trying to get us to play. He used to make you play on edge. And that's when you play on edge, that's when you play your best.